You are listening to a sermon by Pastor Christopher Sally of New Life Christian Fellowship Church.
What is this thing called?
How many people know who this is singing this?
Oh, love.
That's Billie Holiday. Yeah.
Just who can solve its mystery? Why should it make a fool of me?
Amen. That's it. Hey, what is this thing?
Cut it off,
brother. Cut it off. Amen. Amen. What is this thing called love? Thank you to Billie Holiday for giving us a musical reminder and a musical prompt, if you will, when we think about love. And we talked about love, and we've been talking about love, preaching out of this series called Learning to Love. Amen. And I believe this is the 10th message in that series about learning to love. And so we have to be in a place where we learn how to love so that we can learn how to follow and we can learn how to obey. And learning to love the Lord with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our strength, with all of our might is more important than anything else. Amen. That's why it's the greatest commandment. But the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 13 is really, I think, thematically asking this question, and he's answering it for us. It's an ask and answer. What is this thing called love, and why is it so important? If you look at 1 Corinthians 12, as we did last week, the second half of verse 31, he says, "And now I will show you the most excellent way." The Apostle Paul is involved in a discussion in 1 Corinthians 12 and 13 and 14. He's talking to the Corinthians about the issues and challenges that they're facing in their church. Amen. And so we talked last week about the mission. We said your mission, if you choose to accept it, and we talked in 1 Corinthians 12, the Apostle Paul says the unifying mission in the body of Christ is what? Edification. That's the business that we're going to be about. Again, of the body of Christ is really found in Luke 4 and 18. We talked about that. But in the body of Christ, the internal mission, what we're trying to get done is we're supposed to be able in the body of Christ to be about the business of edification. And it is a mission impossible if we don't have love. Amen. And so he said in 1 Corinthians 12, the unifying mission in the body of Christ is edification. Then he talked about the unifying might in the body of Christ is the Holy Spirit. That's our secret weapon. It's who God has given us, the very person of himself. He has given us his spirit so that he might allow us to, he provides where he guides. And so he is not told us to do something, given us a requirement without giving us the resource. He says, listen, the unifying might in the body of Christ is the Holy Spirit. And then the unifying manifestations in the body of Christ are the gifts. Amen. And he says the Holy Spirit is in charge of the gift giving program. And he says, you've got the Spirit and you've got the gifts. And if that were enough, we would not see all of the issues and the challenges and the problems that were in the Corinthian church that he talked about over and over and over again. Starting in chapter 1, I told you, he said, listen, but there's divisions among you, and there's quarrels, and then there's stunted spiritual growth, and there's immorality, there's lawsuits and confusion and even more confusion, and there's coarse behavior. All of these things, he says you've got all of the gifts. Everything is operating. You got all of the gifts. Clearly you have the Holy Spirit, but you obviously are missing something. There's a key element that's not allowing you to fulfill the mission, but you need something to turn that mission impossible into a mission possible. And that's why I told you that the Apostle Paul says right there in chapter 13, that the unifying motivation in the body of Christ is love. He said, let me show you a more excellent way. Clearly, you're coming up short on the mission. And to use that analogy, you cannot be a part of the impossible mission force without love. That's the unifying motivator and motivation in the body of Christ. It seems odd that 1 Corinthians 13 is where it is, but it's not. The Apostle Paul says, I got to show you a more excellent way. 1 Corinthians 12, he's talking about some things, and then he says, let me show you a more excellent way. Then he gets back to, let me show you that everything needs to be done decently and in order. And so the unifying mark in the body of Christ is order. Amen. But that's how the Apostle Paul progresses it. But he ties it all together. He says, because the most excellent way, again, we're back to this, it has to be about love. And the level to which he needs you and me to love is at the agape level. Not just the phileo level, because that won't get it done. We need to operate in love at the what? Agape level. Because the agape level is God's kind of love. It's that sacrificial love. It's that sustaining love. Amen. It is that selfless love. And as I told and reminded all of us collectively last week, the antithesis of agape love is selfishness. Selfishness is always at the root of everything that is going wrong with us personally and in the body of Christ. When we allow self to get in it, we mess it up. Amen. God did his part. He said, I'm going to give you a mission, and I'm going to give you the might of the Holy Spirit, and I'll give you the manifestations of the Spirit. But I need you to have the right motivation. Otherwise, you're going to fall short of the mark. And so what is this thing called love? The Apostle Paul says, if I speak, I'm in verse 1 of 13, if I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. As I told you last week, these first three verses tell us about the power of love. Amen. Shout out to Luther Vandross, the power of love. Amen. They tell us about the power. I saw some smiles break across some faces when I mentioned Big Luther, though, not Little Luther, Big Luther. Big Luther. Talking about the power of love. Here's the power of love. He says, listen, if I speak in the tongues of men and angels but have not love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. The power of love here is that love gives meaning to great words. Amen. Love gives meaning to great words. So again, he says, if I could have the ability to speak in every dialect and tongue known on earth, and the power of that is you think about Acts chapter 2 when you had all of those folks and then they began to speak and everybody heard the message of God in their own language. He said, if I could do that, he said, and even this prayer language, even this the tongue language, the tongue of men and angels. He said, if I had that ability and I had it better than anybody, if I could do all of that and I don't have love, I will sound like a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. There is, you and I have all been to a, call it fourth grade band concert. Amen. Has anybody been to a fourth grade? Come on, a fourth grade band concert. Resounding gongs and clanging cymbals. When you think about operating with great words, without love, think of a fourth grade band concert. There's a lot of effort. There's a lot of parents that are doing like this, and they're squinting, and they're doing, it's like, okay, yeah, but it's fourth grade. Hang out with them till sixth grade and seventh grade and eighth grade, and then you'd be like, oh, okay, I went to Josiah's eighth grade concert, end of the year concert. Oh, they were putting work in. Josiah had a trumpet solo. You know, they had the jazz band come out. They had the teacher sit in with them. Teachers don't sit in with you if you can't play. Amen. I can guarantee you that teacher was not sitting in on Josiah's fourth grade band concert. I believe I was there for that as well. And I was happy to see the progress that they all collectively made. But again, resounding gong, clanging cymbal, it's like it's just a bunch of noise if you don't have love, because love, the power of love, is gives meaning to great words. Amen. Then he says, if I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. It's not even what I do amounts to nothing. He literally says, I am nothing. So love not only gives meaning to great words, love gives merit to great worship. It gives merit. It gives it some substance. It gives it some merit to great worship. He says, if I was able to be in the body of Christ and be able to preach out of my socks, and I had all of the knowledge, he says, you know what? Remember, in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, he already told them, knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. If you have all that knowledge, but you're not utilizing it with love, it literally is like you'll get puffed up like you're taking it all in. But if you don't have the proper outlet through love, you'll just puff up and eventually you'll blow up. Amen. With that head knowledge, and you know the part that'll blow up more again is your head. You'll get the big head. Amen. You'll begin to think you're better than everybody else because you have that. The only thing that gives merit to great worship, or somebody, he says here, if I had the faith that could move mountains. And again, people are looking at me in the body of Christ, and I have that gift of faith, and it's an outsized gift, and it's a great gift. He said, but if I don't operate in love, if I operate in selfishness, and again, remember, the antithesis of love is what? Selfishness is when you put you in it instead of you putting God in it. You will operate in selfishness as opposed to in agape love. And when you do that, your love will, your great works, your great worship will not have any what? Merit. So the power of love is love gives what? Meaning to great words. Love gives merit to great worship. And then he says, if I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. That's when you're doing the right thing, but you're doing it for the wrong reason. I've told you many times, and you know it too, motivation matters. The Apostle Paul says over and over, you look at the Pharisees, it matters. You look at those that were preaching in Philippi and Philippians chapter 1, motivation matters. He says some are preaching Christ out of conceit and self-ambition. Others are preaching him out of love. He said it matters. The motivation, it matters. And so love gives measure to great works. Amen. If you're gonna do it like the Pharisees, to be seen and to be applauded, to make somebody else feel inferior, then he says you literally have gotten your reward. And in Matthew 23, he says, everything they do, Jesus said, everything they do is for people to see. They make their phylacteries, which is a little leather and wood, I believe, box that used to hold the law in it, and they would strap those phylacteries to their foreheads, I think, or maybe to their arms as well. But he said they make their phylacteries wide and the tassels on their garments long. He said that's what they do. Woe to you, teachers of the law and the Pharisees, you hypocrites! You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin, but you have neglected the more important matters of the law. The King James says the weightier matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former. So they were so concerned about tithing that they were like, listen, we go through our household spices, our regular spices. We're giving a tenth of our spices. Look how great we are. He said, but you're giving a tenth of your spices, but you're leaving the weightier matters to somebody else. Justice, mercy, and faithfulness. He said, you got to do the former, but don't forget about the latter. Amen. Motivation matters because love gives meaning to great words. Love gives merit to great worship, and love gives measure to great works. So what are the divine mathematics behind this? Great works plus great worship plus great works minus love equals zero. Amen. You put that. If you don't have love, everything amounts to zero. But if you put love in front of it, you can begin to have numbers that count. Amen. You put a one in front of a zero, it becomes a 10. Now you got a number that registers. Amen. So that's the divine mathematics around it. You become feckless or irrelevant without love. Feckless is a word that that I got acquainted with when I was in college. It literally means without weight. You become like dust. You don't have any impact. So what you do and who you are in the body of Christ and the impact you bring is like dust. All you got to do to get rid of dust is blow it away. You got no weight, no lasting value. That's what the Apostle Paul says. Anything that you do, great words, great worship, or great works, without love, it's weak and ineffective like dust. So then he says, listen, let me get real with you. And he says, let me give you some things that you need to know about what love is and what love is not. Now we're talking about our text. Now we're talking about the practice of love. He said, let's get practical. And everything that he's talking about is prescriptive for all of the issues that they're facing. He says, you guys are dealing with division. You're dealing with quarrels. You're dealing with stunted spiritual growth. You're dealing with confusion. You're dealing with lawsuits. You're dealing with coarse behavior. You're dealing with all of those issues and challenges, immorality in the church. He says, let me be very practical with you and give you what love looks like. What is this thing called love? The Apostle Paul says, I'm going to tell you the power of it. Now I'm going to show you the practice of it. He said, love is first and foremost, it's what? It's patient. And the emphasis on that word is, it's not patient with circumstances. That's easier for us. We can be. It's not patient with circumstances, it's patient with people. Now, if you think you got a short fuse thinking about God having you in some circumstances that are uncomfortable, I think maybe it's just me. Many of us would say, now listen, I'll put up with the circumstances, but she got one more time. And I'm going to set all of my salvation aside. I'm going to deal with this. The Apostle Paul says, when you do that, you're not fulfilling the mission. Amen. That's not going to bring us to edification. Amen. If you don't operate with patience, again, that would help us to deal with the divisions, the quarrels, the lawsuits that they're facing. Amen. He says you got to operate with some patience. Love suffers so it can win the person and help them live, work, and serve as they should. Amen. The love is patient so that it could help the person, so it can win the person. Amen. So when we interact with one another with patience, we win the person and we help them to live, work, and serve as they should. What's the second thing that love is? Love is what? It's kind. Love is kind. It's courteous. It's helpful. Again, that will help, I would think, to deal with some of the quarrels that they had. Ephesians 4 and 32 says, be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as Christ in God forgave you. Amen. He says, let me help you to see. You need to love them like you have what? You've been loved. So again, he said, love is patient. Love is kind. And then he goes into this series of things to tell you. I can tell you what it is, but let me make sure I let you know what it's not. It does not envy. So love is not envious. And so if you were making two lists, if you were writing this down, you would say what love is, what love is not. The first two things love is patient, love is kind. The first thing love is not envious. It does not downplay, attack, or begrudge others' success, standing, or possessions. Amen. Love is not envious. When you have a envious kind of spirit, today we would call you a what? You a hater. You a hater. Who wants to be a hater? You need to be motivated by your haters, but who wants to be the one who's always hating on what somebody else does? Amen. And if you have that kind of envious kind of spirit on you and that envious kind of outlook or perspective, that's how you end up having divisions and quarrels. That's how you end up asking this question. The original question you might ask God is, why not me? And God can help you deal with that. Why not me? Why am I not on? But that envy question goes to why not? It's not just why not me. Why me? Why not me and why her? Why not me and why him? That's that extra stank that gets put on it like that. It's just a little bit extra when you are saying, no. I can appreciate that I might not be in a position to get this job promotion. But why in the world did he get it? Him? How did he get it and not me? It'd be one thing to say not me, but it's why not me and why him? That's envy. And he says love does not envy. It does not downplay, attack, or begrudge others' success. And when you do that, you're not being spiritually mature. When you do that, that shows stunted spiritual growth. Amen. That's what he was talking about in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He said, I would want to feed you solid food, but I can't. You're still stuck on this milk because you're not spiritual. You're what? You're carnal. You can't move on. You're not progressing like you should. If you have a spirit that is begrudging others, he said, you're not going to love properly. And if you don't love properly, you won't fulfill the mission. He says something else. Love is not. Love is not what? Boastful. It does not boast. That's when you come up and you get yours. This is all in the same family of problems. Amen. You envy somebody else. And then when you come up, you start getting really stank with everybody. Again, stank is a good word to use when talking to and about black people. I'm just talking to myself. I'm talking to you too, because you remember that we talked about this before. In the place of provision, the enemy wants you to be boastful and God wants you to be grateful. Amen. And in Deuteronomy chapter 8, God warned them. He said, when you get into the land, he said, don't transfer your trust from the provider to the provision. He said, don't do it. Don't say my power and the might of my hand hath gotten me this wealth. You have to be grateful and realize God is the one that allowed you to get whatever it is that you've gotten. He said, when you get into that place of provision, don't make the mistake of what the enemy would have you do, which is to be boastful. God wants you to be grateful. So love is not what? It's not boastful. Love is not proud. Love is not proud. Look at the situation in Luke chapter 14. It says, when someone invites you to a wedding, don't take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come to you and say, give this person your seat. Then humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you're invited, take the low place, so that when your host comes, he will say, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of all the guests. For all those who exalt themselves will be humble, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. You imagine you're sitting at the wrong table. You're at the reserve table. You're at the wedding party table. You're not in the wedding party. They're definitely going to tell you, and again, all wedding coordinators, they're made out of the same stuff. They do not play. You in the wrong seat. Your seat is over there, table 49, over there by the door where you get hit in the head from the kitchen, they bringing the stuff out. That's your seat. This is for the wedding party. You want to be that guy? You want to be that girl that has to get moved? Go sit by table 49 and they can tell you maybe you got a better table. But again, he says it's all about your perspective. He says those that exalt themselves will be humble, and those that humble themselves will be what? Exalted. Because James 4:6 says, but he giveth more grace, for God opposes the proud, but he gives shows favor to the humble. So it's not envious, it's not boastful, it's not proud. I love this. It is not rude. It's not rude. Did you hear what I said? Excuse me, did you hear what God said through the Apostle Paul? These Negroes in Corinth, if you look at 1 Corinthians 11, these cats were off the chain when it came to the Lord's Supper. And so the Lord's Supper that we took today, again, the communion with the emblems, it was incorporated into this larger thing called the love feast. They would get together like hospitality. All right? Let's all get together for a meal, and we're going to really celebrate. We're going to get together. We're going to have the meal, and we're going to really fellowship, really try to deepen our koinonia, amen, our fellowship. In 1 Corinthians 11, he was like, in the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. No doubt there have been differences. So when you come together, it's not the Lord's supper you eat. For when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. As a result, one person remains hungry and another one gets drunk. He said, what are you all doing at the hospitality time? He says, the rich folks, you all are bringing in your own food. And then you're serving it amongst your own friends. And somebody else who is in the church who doesn't have what you have can't sit at your table. Their stomach is grumbling. They leave hungry and you leave filled. And you're causing these divisions. And you got all of these little groups that are meeting together. And you're excluding people. And he said, and some of you Negroes are coming in here getting drunk. That's not what this is about. The Lord's. Our fellowship meal, it's like you're supposed to maybe have a glass of wine, as Timothy would say, for your stomach's sake. Amen. But you all are hitting the bottle kind of hard. He said, all of this is not right. He says, you all are being rude to one another. That's not what fellowship is all about. People are leaving angry. People are leaving hungry. People are leaving drunk. So that's not what we are supposed to be about the business of doing. They were being rude to one another, indecent and ill-mannered. Love is not any of those things. Amen? It's not self-seeking. It does not insist on its own rights, but puts others first. Philippians 2:3-4 says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, rather in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each one to the interest of others. It's not, what did I just say? It's not what? Self-seeking. Literally, that's what agape love is. It's selfless. It's not self-seeking. The Apostle Paul had to make that point because humility allows us to connect with one another. Amen. Pride causes us to be distant from one another. If you want to exalt yourself, you'll be by yourself. Amen. But if you consider other people's interests, that's how we will be able to what? Connect. He says it's not easily angered. Love overrides the anger emotion. The way I like to say it is, love takes a deep breath. My dear brothers and sisters, James 1 says, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. I could slap her right now, but I won't. You better get out my face. No, don't do that. It's not easily angered. And if it's not easily angered, then you're probably not going to end up downtown in court with the person that you felt wronged you. What the Apostle Paul was talking about, the divisions and the quarrels and all of that. He says, just take a deep breath. It's going to be okay. That's what love does. Love takes a deep breath. And then he flips over and he says, love is forgetful because it keeps no record of wrongs. Baby, you cannot learn to love people and not learn how to forget. And when I say forget, it means you say when you think of it, it comes to your mind, you don't use it against them ever again. That's really tapping into forgiveness. Amen. Isn't it? Do not repay evil for evil or insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing, because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. That's what 1 Peter 3:9 says. 1 Thessalonians says, make sure nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. You got to be forgetful, not resentful, forgiving, not holding grudges. And then he says, love is not pleased with evil. Amen. It keeps no record. Love does not delight in evil. In 1 Corinthians 5, he talks about a man has his father's wife, and he says, you all seem to think that's okay. You all are literally shoulder shrugging or rejoicing in the fact that somebody's doing something that they shouldn't be doing. You cannot be a cheerleader for unrighteousness. Not in the body of Christ. There's some things that we need to do to restore our brothers and sisters who go astray and do some things wrong. And that's what the Apostle Paul says. I'm going to set some things in order when I come. But he says we can't, in the meantime, in between time, we can't be a cheerleaders for unrighteousness. Part of not being a cheerleader for unrighteousness is you're not spreading stories about bad behavior or making excuses for it. Amen. You're not tolerating it. You're mourning it. Don't tolerate it. Mourn it. Mourn it because you hoping that godly sorrow will lead to repentance. Amen. You're not tolerating it, but you are mourning it. And then it says, it always protects, it always trusts, it always hopes, it always endures. Before that, though, it's joyful in the truth. I'm sorry. Joyful in the truth. Again, promotes and is excited by truth and the freedom that comes with it. Whom the Son has set free, he is free indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall what? Set you free. Excited about the truth and the freedom that comes with it, the knowledge that truth is a person and you prioritize truth above everything else. Stand firm then with the what? Belt of truth buckled around your waist. Again, that's part of the armor of God. We have to be people of truth. And it's loyalty to one another, loyalty above all else except truth. The safest ground that you and I can be standing on is when we're standing on truth, because truth is a person and his name is Jesus Christ. So we want to stand with truth and we want to do what? Rejoice in the truth. And then it always protects. It's protectful. It bears up under the weight and the onslaught of things coming at the relationship. And when you're protectful, you're willing to take the flak and not expose the other person to hurt, harm, or danger. You're saying to them to take I'm not going to leave my wingman. I'm not going to leave my wingman. If we're flying a mission and I'm supposed to be here, no matter what I see, no matter what happens, no matter what danger I find myself in, I made a determination I'm not going to leave my wingman, because if I leave him, I'm going to leave him unprotected, and love always protects. Love always trusts. It sees the good and forgives and relies on the love of God that binds us and ministers to us. It does its job even if others don't do their job. Amen. Ultimately, we're trusting in the deep and sustaining love of God. So again, even if I can't trust the person that I'm in relationship with and I've been hurt before, I'm still trusting the one who brought us together. I'm still trusting the one who loves me and will sustain me and will allow his love to flow through me so that I might love them in a trustful way. And it's always hopeful. The hope of salvation and a future that's based on God's love. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. You've got to be hopeful in what God has already secured in terms of our future. And when we know where we're going and we know who is getting us there, we can always maintain that hope. And then it says, it always perseveres. That's a military word that says it stands against the attack of the enemy. Love fights, love struggles, love overcomes. That's why it says in Galatians 6 and 9, let us not be weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. He says, don't give up, because love never gives up. It's always protectful. It's always trustful. It's always hopeful. It's always enduring.
Yes.
That's the practice of love, you all. That's what the apostle says. And it's prescriptive, because he said every issue you're facing, every problem, everything that's coming up in your church, if you can learn how to love in literally these 15 ways, he says patient, kind, forgiveful, joyful in truth, protectful, trustful, hopeful, and enduring. That's what love is. What love is not, it's not envious. It's not boastful. It's not proud. It's not rude. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered, and it is not pleased with evil. He said if you can do that, you will realize the truth of it is love never fails. And it never fails if you practice it the way it's supposed to be practiced. Amen? And so he finally concludes then with the priority of love. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they'll cease. Their tongues, they'll be still. Where there's knowledge, it'll pass away. For we know in part and prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. He said, when I was a child, I reasoned like a child. I thought like a child. I talked like a child. When I became a man, I put childish things behind me. He's saying to them, it's childish to play with gifts like a kid plays with toys. You ever see kids when they're hanging out, all they care about is the next 2 minutes, 3 minutes, to run here, to run there. And many times we look back and say, man, so cool if I could be a child again. Don't have a care in the world. But you know, when you grow up, there's other priorities that you have to have besides playing and besides juice boxes and video games. You know, that's just not, life is complicated and it's real. And he said, stop thinking like a child. He said, but when I grew up and became a man, I put away childish things. The childish thing he wants you to put away is thinking that because you've got a gift and you're exercising it, that some kind of way you're being edifying to the body of Christ. He said, if you're doing it without love, it's going to, if it's minus love, it's a big goose egg. He said, stop thinking like a child. Think like a grown-up. And a grown-up knows that nothing matters in terms of what gets accomplished for edifying the body of Christ if you don't do it motivated by love. He knows that. And he says, listen, we see a poor reflection as in a mirror. We'll see face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, even as I am known. Now he said, now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. And love is the highest priority. It must be, because love literally obliterates selfishness. It literally blows selfishness up. That's what God wants. He wants to get you away from yourself so that you can get more of him and less of you. That's how you become a disciple. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Self-denial leads to discipleship. He says, listen, there are three things that remain. These three graces, if you will. It's faith, and faith will become sight. Hope will be fulfilled. But love is the greatest because it will continue to be expressed always between us and our God. God calls us and pursues a continuing love relationship with us that's both real and personal. Somebody who's been in the Experiencing God Bible study should know what I'm talking about. God pursues a continuous love relationship with us that's both real and personal. It continues not just for time, but for eternity. That's why the greatest thing is love. So God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Everything that God does is based upon his love for us. Amen. He loves us. He doesn't love us just for time. He loves us for eternity. And he says, I need you to love at my level. Amen. What is this thing called love? There's a power to it that you got to grasp. There's a practice to it that you need to participate in, and you need to understand the priority of it. It is eternal. God loves us with an eternal love, and he said that love is never going away. That's it right there. And he says, I want you to understand it, and I want you to get on board with it, so that you can do what you need to do to edify the body of Christ. Amen.